Okay, so we all are aware of the basic data models which are available in DHIS too. So we have two broad models in which we collect data. So just to refresh people on the data models and the people who are relatively new to DHIS too. So District Health Information System, that is DHIS2, allows two kinds of broad data types to be captured through its framework. One is the aggregate model, where you kind of enter pre-summarized information in terms of numbers on a fixed frequency, which could start from daily and then can range from weekly, 6 monthly, monthly, quarterly, annual, and different frequencies which are available depending upon the kind of data you're collecting and at what frequency you would like to collect this data based on your program data and monitoring evaluation needs. Then we have the data sets, which are basically the source through which you're collecting your aggregate information. So you define your data elements, which are your placeholders for the information which you want to capture, and you combine your data elements into a data set, which basically becomes your reporting form for your data collection. Then we have tracker model, which has two components. Most of us are aware of this terminology, the event programs and the tracker programs. The key difference between the event and the tracker programs is the kind of data which you're capturing. So when we talk about event programs, basically these are line listing registers where we are making note or making a record of one specific event, and we are not tracking the event program. We are not tracking the specific information that we are capturing in the event program, but we are creating instances of an event which are happening in our program. So the most basic examples are, for example, a birth registration program where you're registering each birth, or a death registration, or any vital event that happens, birth, deaths, marriages. You can kind of make a record of it and store it as a electronic information in your system. More relevant examples could be many organizations conduct these behavioral change events or SBCC events, where they just want to make note of when the event was conducted, where the event was conducted, how many participants it came up, how many male, how many female, just basic information for that specific event, which happened at one point of time, and you want to make a note of it. Then the other thing is tracker programs. As the name says, tracker, it means that you're tracking individuals or tracking a respective entity, which could be anything from a person to a household to a village to a lab sample to a commodity. So given the data model and the nature of DHIS2 is very generic and flexible, you could define the entity which you want to track. So the more we go ahead with the tracker concepts, we will see that in our use cases, what use cases are we going to cover and how we have modified the DHIS2 data model to capture data for our use cases. So tracker programs would allow you to track a person over a period of time through different services which you provide to that person, which could be either based on a clinical protocol, as we've seen for HIV and TB programs, where you have fixed follow-up visits to be done at certain point of time to kind of maintain the continuum of care. Or you could have ad hoc reporting on the basis of the visits the person makes to the clinic to get services from a physician or a doctor. So you can apply the tracker programs to different use cases. We will be covering two broad use cases for COVID surveillance and COVID vaccination, which were taken up hugely on the DHIS2 platform over the last 2 years, over the course of the pandemic. In case you have a specific use case which you would like to discuss, please feel free to put that use case on the Slack channel, and we would be happy to discuss those use cases with you individually, or if you have time during the academy, then we could also take up some interesting examples and discuss those. So as I just mentioned, so event programs collect individual data, but there are no registrations involved. That means you're not tracking an individual person, item, or a substance. So these are useful when you need granular data, but you don't want to track and perform any individual level follow-up. Okay. So as I mentioned, that you want to capture data for births, for deaths, for maternal deaths, but then you're not tracking that specific event. You just want to make note of that event and the data which is associated to it. Okay. So any sort of survey, surveillance line list which you're creating, they could be your event programs. You need to have a good foundation of the event programs and the event data model before you start configuring your event programs for your area of work or your organization. There is a DHIS2 event fundamental course available online. We will share the link of that on the Slack channels as well. You could go and join that course, which will take you through to the basics of the events model, which covers both events and tracker. So that would be a useful start for people who are looking to adapt trackers as in their respective areas, tracker plus events both. Now, as I mentioned, tracker programs, they will collect individual data. They will involve registration of a person or an item or a substance. So this would involve the registration and subsequent follow-ups for that specific tracked entity, which you're trying to track over a period of time. So here, since we're talking about individuals, we were talking about persons or lab samples or households or villages, we always need some unique identifiers to identify the system across the, identify the person or the entity across the programs. Where a person could be enrolled into multiple programs. So I have programs in my system for HIV, TB, and non-communicable diseases. So as a patient, I could be part of multiple disease registries, but in order to identify that specific patient in the system, you need to have some set of identifiers available, which could be your national ID, which could be your health ID or individual program ID, depending upon what unique identifiers does the program considers when it comes to data collection and use moving ahead. As we have seen already, that the tracker programs will have more consideration in terms of identifying such unique attributes and personal identifiable information. They're more complex as compared to the event data model. And during the course, we will be spending time to understand this model in more detail. And we will see how we can use the tracker capture in terms of data collection, in terms of data analysis, both on web and Android, so that the foundations of the use of tracker capture in specific use cases is easily understandable to you, so that you can adapt the learnings into your specific programs as well. So our target audiences for this academy are people who want to understand DHIS2 tracker and want to know that how they can use tracker for data entry and the associated analytics. In addition to this course, this will just give you an overview of the tracker use, but we have several other courses which are being planned and will run online over the course of next year as well. So you have tracker configuration. We are planning to have a course in December this year for configuration. So this would take you through the more detailed concepts of DHIS2 events and tracker data model, and it will take you to the details of how you actually configure your events and tracker programs. Then we have a specific course on Android implementation. So Android implementations will have their own considerations in terms of choosing your devices, rolling out your devices in the field, using mobile device management systems, in terms of the technical functionalities, how does Android differ from the web and what kind of considerations you want to keep in mind if you are doing the Android implementation. So that's a specific course that has been developed to help organizations and the community who are looking to use the DHIS2 Android app for their program implementations. Then we started a new course last year or earlier this year on tracker implementation management. So basically, the first two parts are really kind of talking about, even this course talks about the technical aspects, But then the implementation is the crucial factor in success of any IT, digital IT implementation. So we have a specific course on tracker implementation management where we share experiences with different partners in use cases which we've already done in the past and what has been their experience in terms of the implementation of tracker system, what learnings they've learned, what challenges they've faced, and how the system can enhance the success criteria of your implementation if you take into account all the considerations which are beneficial for the tracker implementations. So I just request everyone to put your mics on mute, please. Yeah, so the course material has a basic assumption that you have taken the event fundamentals online or you've had similar experience of working with events model in the HIS2. So in case there are some terms which are not clear because of your lack of experience with the HIS2 before, then please do make notes and let the facilitators know on Slack. They will try to make you understand as much as possible so that you can keep up the pace with the course content and the days to follow. So the learning goals of the academy are to kind of increase the level of understanding of the features which are available within DHIS2 Tracker, increase the ability to enter tracker data, utilize all the features which are there as part of data entry, both on web and Android, and increase the ability to create outputs from the tracker data. So we'll have a look at how you can aggregate the case-based information you're collecting in tracker or the line listing information you're collecting in events, and how you can associate and triangulate different data sources in your DHIS2 instance when you're using aggregate and tracker systems together. So we'll have dedicated sessions on those. The performance objectives are to explain what DHIS2 tracker is and what different methods you can capture the tracker data, how you can utilize the different data to capture methods to enter tracker data for your specific programs, how you can review the tracker data and generate outputs using the inbuilt analysis tools in DHIS2, and how over the course of few past years, what supplementary applications we've seen that can enhance the use of DHIS2 ability to create tracker data outputs. So we have examples from a couple of custom web applications which were developed during the pandemic for enhancing the capabilities of the tracker related output. So we'll have some examples of those and we'll show you how things can be extended apart from the default core functionalities which are available as part of the analytics package of DHIS2. So we'll go through the latest tracker features and we'll show you how to use them. We'll have sessions on the tracker data model later today. We'll have a look at both web and the Android application on how we can capture data for the tracker data model. We'll identify the applications which are used to analyze the tracker data, both in terms of line list and aggregate numbers. And we'll have a look at the different types of visualizations that we can do using tracker data, which are tables, charts, and maps, and how the dashboards could be utilized to plot the tracker data and use those dashboards as a mechanism to visualize the information, analyze information, and disseminate the information with your team members across the organization. So just quickly taking you through to the course overview, we are at day one today. We were discussing the introduction to the academy. We will be using Moodle as our learning platform. So we will introduce you to Moodle and DHIS2 instances, which you will be using over the course of next 5 days for performing different graded and ungraded exercises. We'll be covering two use cases in this academy, one related to COVID surveillance, one related to COVID vaccination. So we'll give an overview of both the use cases, how the program have been set up and what is the workflow that the program envisages. Then we'll have a look at the tracker data model, the various components and the key terminologies which we will be using through next 5 days. Day two will focus upon the tracker capture web and tracker capture Android, where we'll see how both the platforms could be used for tracker data collection. Day three will focus on the analysis of tracker data on Android. So in recent developments which have happened in the Android application, offline analytics and in-device analytics have been developed as part of the new functionalities and enhancements. So we'll have a look at those. And then we'll also have a look at the event reports app in the web version on how you can generate the data from the event reports app. Day four, we'll look at three applications: Event Visualizer, which is another app available to visualize tracker data. Then we have the Maps app to visualize the tracker and events data, and how we can use program indicators to aggregate our tracker and events data, and how that those indicators can be used in the analytics apps such as Maps and Data Visualizer to plot various visualization items and use them on our dashboards. Day five, we'll have a small session on the custom apps for tracker data, which have been recently developed and were intensively used in the COVID surveillance programs and the COVID vaccination program as well. We have an exam, which would be basically multiple choice questions based on the contents that were covered during the last 4 days in the academy. And we will be having a small closing session to gather feedback from you and tell you the plans for the next academies that are in the pipeline moving ahead. So in terms of the academy certification process, the course has your ungraded exercises, which are just built for building your understanding. There's no marking done for these specific ungraded exercises. There are graded assignments which will cover the grades of the course, the minimum and a final exam, which also contributes to your overall score. We have set an overall grade of 70% for between the graded assignment and the final exam for you to pass the course. We kind of judging you on the basis of the assignments and the exams. The questions would be from the material which is shared with you on daily sessions and recordings. And if you attend or view the sessions later on as well, if you're not available to join during the academy hours, you should be fine. You will be more than be able to do the assignments as well as the exam. So this is the weightage which has been given to different components. You have your daily attendance, so that contributes to 10% to your overall grade. There are assignments related to each topic, which are the graded assignments for data entry, web and Android, Android analysis, event visualizer and reports, maps, programmatic analysis, and exam. So each of them has more or less equal weighted. So make sure that you submit all your graded assignments and do appear for the final examination so that it contributes to your overall grade of 70%, which is the passing criteria. So the exercise and assignments are basically based on the learning by doing. The ungraded exercises are there for every session. The graded assignments are there for some of the sessions. You will have ample amount of time to do both the ungraded exercises and the graded exercises during the course. The major input or submission that are required from you are the graded assignments, which are to be done after the sessions. And you could reach out to us via the Slack channel if you have any questions or clarifications on the assignments which are given to you. You will have some buffer time to complete all your assignments by Friday, November 5th. So in case you're not able to finish these assignments during the course of this week, you'll have a week more to submit your graded assignments, knowing that we all are doing this course in between our work commitments. So we understand we might not be able to do everything at once. So you'll have a buffer of 1 week to submit your grid assignments so that your scores are added to the exam and your certificates could be generated accordingly. So the exam would be on day 5. That is fixed. That cannot be extended. But your graded assignments will be extended by a week so that you can cover those during the course of the next week preceding the academy. So if there are any questions, please feel free to ask, or you can put them on the chat box or use the Slack channel to ask questions. We'll prefer using Slack because we lose history of the chats after the meeting ends today. So please put your questions on the Slack channel, and there is a team of facilitators who will be answering your questions at the earliest possible. That was all for the first presentation, and I think we've done the mentee session already. For the attendance, we will share a word of the day in Zoom chat every day. You need to add this word of the day in the daily attendance quizzes, and you'll have 3 attempts in case you misspell or copy the word incorrectly. So if you enter the word of the day, that means you have gone through the sessions, and we will also put the word of the day in the course recordings as well, so that if you're not able to attend the sessions live, you can review the recordings and identify the word of the day and put it into the Moodle platform so that your attendance is counted for that specific day. So please ensure that you report the word of the day for each day so as to get your attendance counted for that specific day. So that was my last slide. I'll check the Slack channel and the chat if there are any questions. I think before we move on to the next session, we can take a quick break. So we meet after 15 minutes. So it's 1 o'clock India time. So we start at 1:15. So we'll start the next session 15 minutes, and we can take a break for now. So thank you so much, and we look forward towards the next session.